In post-Soviet Russia, Lenin is no longer the hero he was. But on air bases like Kubinka, just outside Moscow, there is another hero that is unlikely to be toppled in the way so many statues of Lenin have been. It is the MiG-21, the great Soviet fighter of the 60s, the best of the world's third generation jet fighter aircraft. The MiG-21 served in 45 countries around the world. More than 8,000 were produced. Many of them are still flying, and Western countries are offering to install new electronics and avionics so they can operate into the 21st century. NATO code named it Fishbed, but more than 20 variants were produced, and the English alphabet was nearly exhausted, adding A's and B's and other letters after the name to distinguish between them. The first Soviet premier after Stalin's death was Georgi Malenkov. One of his first actions to make headlines in the West was the denunciation and firing of his deputy premier, Lavrenty Beria, who had run Stalin's secret police. The new general secretary of the Communist Party was war veteran Nikita Khrushchev. In 1955, Marshal Nikolai Bulganin replaced Malenkov as premier. War veteran Marshal Zhukov was defense minister. Bulganin could not have reached office without the support of Nikita Khrushchev, who was consolidating his own position as the most powerful man in the Soviet Union. In July 1955, just a month after the Eastern Bloc countries signed the Warsaw Pact, their formal alliance against the NATO countries, a Big Four summit was held in Geneva. President Eisenhower there suggested an open sky policy in which the Soviet Union and the United States could share defense information, but this was not adopted by the summit. Since the late 40s, America and the Soviet Union had been locked in a weapons technology battle. As far as fighter aircraft was concerned, the driving force of that battle was speed. With the success of the MiG-15 and 17, the design bureau of Artyom Mikoyan and Mikhail Gurevich leapfrogged its rivals Yakovlev and Lavochkin to a position of eminence in the design of Soviet fighter aircraft. The MiG bureau had come a long way since its establishment in 1939. Its World War II fighter, the MiG-3, had not been a great success. The jet MiG-15 had won its position against stiff competition because of a combination of performance, strength, and simplicity. The MiG-17 offered more of the same, with greater wing sweep and greater power, but it was still not a supersonic aircraft. The MiG-19 was to be a fighter that could not only exceed Mach 1, but could operate comfortably at supersonic speeds. The step from the subsonic fighters to genuine Mach 1 capability was a big one. It placed great technological demands on the design team. Vasily Arkhipov was the leading engineer for the flight tests of the MiG-19. He says that a truly supersonic fighter became possible because of higher wing sweep angles and the higher thrust of new jets. The MiG-19 was fitted with two Mikulin AM-5 afterburner engines with axial compressors. Unlike the engines of the MiGs-15 and 17, they were designed by Russians. By late May 1952, while Joseph Stalin was still alive, the MiG-19 was ready for its first flight. Originally, the horizontal tail surface of the MiG-19 had a conventional elevator. It was discovered in tests that this did not give sufficient control power at transonic speeds, so a one-piece flying tail of the kind pioneered on the American X-1 was fitted. Later prototypes had Mikulin AM-5 engines with about 25% more thrust. In March 1954, a MiG-19 reached Mach 1.33, unofficially breaking the world speed record. But to preserve Soviet secrecy, the record was not claimed. The official record at the time was held by the prototype of this fighter, the North American F-100 Super Sabre. It was the MiG-19's closest American counterpart. The F-100 developed as a fighter bomber and never met the MiG-19 in combat. Comparisons indicate that the MiG-19 would have held its own in speed, climb, and maneuverability, but the F-100 had greater payload, range, and more sophisticated armament. In the mid-50s, American intrusions into Soviet airspace were usually carried out as far as possible from air defense fighter bases. A rocket-assisted version of the MiG-19 was developed as a quick reaction fighter and tested. There was great concern about the G-loading the test pilot, Georgi Shianov, would have to endure. When it was launched successfully in April 1957, the acceleration force on Shianov was 6G. There were more test flights, but the growing success of surface-to-air missiles cancelled out the need for such a radical solution. Shianov was made a hero of the Soviet Union. For the Soviet Air Force, the MiG-19 was a major leap forward in technology, capable not only of operating above the speed of sound, but of carrying air-to-air missiles and using ground control intercept systems. The MiG-19P on display in the Monino Air Force Museum outside Moscow is an all-weather interceptor of the Air Defense Force. Air defense fighters were designed to respond to threats entering Soviet airspace, and were stationed widely throughout the Soviet Union. MiG-19Ps were equipped with radar and armed with K-5 missiles. One version of the MiG-19P had the first command link connecting it with ground intercept stations. The link transmitted voice and weapons guidance commands. The twin afterburner engines gave the 19 the power to fly at supersonic speeds. The flying tail, known as a stabilator, gave the control power to cope with instability at those speeds. But on early tests with the flying tail, control below the speed of sound was too sensitive, a phenomenon dreaded by pilots, PIO, pilot-induced oscillation, began to occur. To compensate, a new intelligent control system was developed. Traditionally, pilots resisted the idea of anything intervening between them and the control surfaces, but it was the only way to attack higher Mach numbers and also retain control at slower speeds. With the new irreversible controls, it was difficult to give the pilot a natural feel, so a system was developed using spring loading to give artificial feedback. It was a forerunner of later fly-by-wire control systems. Loss of cabin pressure was a risk. The MiG-19 could fly at high altitudes for long periods of time. This meant that high-altitude combat was a possibility, and also meant that a hit from an opponent could cause a loss of cabin pressure. Pressure suits for fighter pilots became a necessity. For the MiG Design Bureau, the 19 was a major achievement. A successful supersonic fighter gave MiG the platform from which to take the next evolutionary step towards Mach 2, twice the speed of sound. In July 1959, US Vice President Richard Nixon visited Moscow and opened the American National Exhibition. In September, Nikita Khrushchev, now Soviet Premier as well as Party Secretary, arrived in the USA. His flamboyant behavior and range of moods impressed Americans and gave some hope that the Cold War might be thawing. But the hardware of the Cold War was well established. The American B-47 bomber had been in production since 1950. The larger intercontinental B-52 had entered service in 1954. Both could carry nuclear weapons, and both were seen by the Soviet Union as a threat. In 1953, the Soviet Air Force issued a requirement partly designed to counter this threat. It was for a fighter that could fly at twice the speed of sound and reach an altitude of almost 66,000 feet. It was to be smaller and lighter than the MiG-19 and capable of operating as an interceptor and as a tactical fighter. Airflow studies were carried out on three separate wing planforms, theoretically capable of performing at Mach 2. One was an ultra-thin, straight-winged arrangement. Another was severely swept, like the MiG-19. The third was a delta plan form, with swept leading and straight trailing edges. At the same time, the Lockheed Company in America was using the ultra-thin, straight wings on its Mach 2-capable F-104 Starfighter. In France, the Dassault company was developing a Mach 2 interceptor, the Mirage, a pure tailless Delta. Past experience was a major factor in the MiG design process. MiG was also very much under the influence of aerodynamic theory developed at the Central Aerodynamics and Hydrodynamics Institute, Tsagi. Tsagi had discovered that Delta-type wings produce much less drag than swept or straight wings. Generally, the thinner the wing relative to its width, the less drag it produces. Delta wings are very wide at the fuselage, and so their relative thinness is greater than any other wing form. Russians call the pure Delta wing the balalaika, because it's shaped like the famous Russian musical instrument. Tsagi's tests show that a pure balalaika planform would not give the runway performance required by the Soviet authorities. They suggested a compromise, a delta wing supplemented by a separate tail. This compromise would also help the aircraft meet other aspects of the requirement. It must fly conventionally and be maneuverable. MiG and Tsagi did not adopt the delta-tail combination without some assurance. They also developed a prototype with swept wings. In 1955, the swept-wing version, the E-2, was fitted with a rocket engine in the base of the fin. The jet engine capable of pushing the prototype to Mach 2 was not yet ready. The E-50, as this version was called, performed well, but the first prototype crashed early in the test program. A second version was prepared. It had control and stability problems at subsonic speeds, which took some time to cure. By June 1957, the problems were fixed, and the aircraft was cleared to explore its performance capabilities. Various forms of the swept wing and delta wing prototypes were tested against each other for 3 years. Artyom Mikoyan came to the conclusion that the delta-tail combination had more promise. experience with the MiG-15 and 17 had demonstrated the virtue of an engine installed in the fuselage with a nose intake. But they were both subsonic aircraft, and as speed increases, the cross-section of the normal nose intake cannot accept the increased airflow. A phenomenon called air intake stall occurs. On early prototypes, a fixed inlet spike was installed to smooth airflow, but as speeds increased beyond Mach 2, it became ineffective. The spike was made adjustable, and that provided the solution to the problem. The spike interacts with the airstream, smoothing the airflow over a wide speed range. The cone system was tested in a Tsagi wind tunnel and as part of the flight test program. It contributed greatly to the high performance of the aircraft that became the MiG-21. The control system was also modified. Originally, the primary control system had been hydraulic and the emergency backup system electrical. But the electrical system had a completely different feel and was a problem to pilots. It was replaced by a second hydraulic system with identical characteristics. By the end of 1958, the first operational MiG-21, the 21F, was ready for service. A batch of 30 aircraft was delivered to operational squadrons. The performance of the MiG-21F was so outstanding that for the first time the Soviets decided to claim official world speed records. The balance between secrecy and propaganda value tipped away from secrecy for the first time. On October the 1st, 1959, MiG Bureau test pilot Georgi Mosolov set the first Soviet official world speed record over a 25-kilometer closed course. The average speed was 2,388 kilometers, almost 1,500 miles an hour. But in spite of this new Soviet openness in claiming the record, the aircraft was given a false name. It was called the E-66. The Tumansky R-11F engine was officially registered as the R-37F. The airport used, actually Zhukovsky, was registered as Podmoskovnaya Airport, which was not really a lie since it means near Moscow. The major goal of Soviet fighter development in the late 50s and early 60s was to reach higher speeds and higher altitudes. The primary emphasis was on all-weather interception of incoming threats rather than confined dogfighting. This meant that canopy visibility in early MiG-21s was not as important as it became later. The basic MiG-21 was modified into many different versions. One of the most obvious differences in outline between models is the shape of the dorsal fairing. It tended to grow as the aircraft developed, housing more equipment and fuel and raising the weight of the aircraft. Like all Soviet fighters, the 21 was designed to use rough, unmade airfields. The landing gear was tough and the wheels were large. The Soviet Air Force required the aircraft to be equipped with air-to-air missiles. Soviet copies of the American Sidewinder were available with the Soviet designation R3S. They provided fire-and-forget capability. Confidence in these missiles was so high that MiG-21s of the early 1960s did not have any cannon. When it became clear that infrared homing missiles could be fooled by countermeasures and were not completely reliable, cannon were reinstalled as a backup. Two major families of MiG-21 developed, distinguished by the fact that in one the cockpit canopy was hinged in front, and the canopy became an aerodynamic shield if ejection was necessary. In the other, the canopy was hinged on the side and simply blew away during ejection. The radar scope was positioned to the center of the instrument panel and had rubber shielding so the pilot could see it in sunlight. The first generation MiG-21s were equipped only to fly daylight clear air interceptions. The second generation was more sophisticated, equipped with radar in the intake spike and able to intercept at night and in poor weather. The MiG-21 was a major step forward for pilots from squadrons of MiG-15s and 17s. They were confronted with a genuine high-altitude, high-speed aircraft capable of flying at twice the speed of sound and reaching altitudes over 60,000 feet. It was three times as fast as anything in their experience. The two-seater MiG-21 UTI trainer helped them to make this transition. It also carried two Soviet women pilots to major world records. Natalia Prokhanova set an absolute women's world altitude record of 79,842 feet. Lydia Zaitseva established a sustained horizontal altitude record of 62,400 feet. This MiG-21 UTI is far away from its original home. It flies out of Burlington, Vermont in the USA. Its owner and pilot, Dean Martin, is a MiG collector. The 21 UTI was the first Soviet jet fighter trainer since the MiG-15. The 15 UTI trained pilots for both the MiG-17 and the MiG-19. The MiG-21, with its vastly extended flight envelope, required much more demanding preparation. Fighter pilot trainees graduated from the Czech L-29 intermediate trainer onto the MiG-21 UTI. In practice, it was not such a daunting transition. The MiG was considered to have handling qualities well in the reach of a 20-year-old cadet of a fighter pilot school. It was known as a forgiving aircraft, but was still demanding. The wing was set up for high-speed flying, and landings could be difficult. Four basic UTIs were produced, each one a conversion of the four generations of the MiG-21 fighter. Many detailed variations on those four models followed. Some were manufactured outside the Soviet Union, in Czechoslovakia, India, and China. Each model of the UTI trainer has the same Tumansky jet engine as its corresponding fighter version. The jet nozzle has controllable vents. They vary in cross-section according to the power setting to give the best possible gas flow from the engine. One of the main problems facing MiG designers in developing the UTI was getting the high-speed ejection sequence just right. Pilot and instructor may need to eject at speeds beyond Mach 2, and the timing of ejection between the two cockpits is critical if they're to have any chance of surviving. All Russian aircraft have instrumentation that reads in meters rather than feet, and kilometers per hour rather than knots, which can be confusing to American pilots. And Western aircraft have an artificial horizon which shows the horizon relative to the pilot's seat. But Russian aircraft have an attitude indicator, which shows the attitude of the aircraft from the point of view of the ground. which is even more confusing. The MiG-21's performance, though, speaks all languages. The second seat in the UTI reduced fuel tank space, and an external fuel tank below the fuselage became standard. Even with the external fuel tank, the range of the two-seater is about 400 miles less than a standard fighter version. Otherwise, performance, speed, altitude, and maneuverability is similar. Sometimes external tanks on Russian aircraft are jettisoned in flight in designated areas. And these tanks are highly prized by the owners of dachas, country holiday cottages. They mount them on top of small cubicles in their backyards and use them as water tanks for their showers. MiG-21s come in fast. Their landing speed is around 170 miles an hour. The landing run is close to 4,000 feet, but the use of a drag chute reduces that by more than half. There is no doubt that the MiG-21 performs and handles well. For two decades, it evolved effectively enough to keep it near the top of the international fighter aircraft tree. It has no basic handling vices. It can be pushed to its limits of performance without risk of a major mishap. Its combination of delta wing and tail makes it resistant to stalling. The design of the nose intake is so efficient that air is supplied smoothly to the engine, even under extreme conditions. It is simple, highly reliable, and could be produced in great numbers, all of which were prime requirements of the Soviet Air Force. It wasn't long after the MiG-21 went into service that the term MiG diplomacy was coined. Many small MiG-21 units were sold to newly independent or post-revolutionary countries in the 60s and 70s. They were supplied on very favorable terms. The price was heavily subsidized by the Soviets, and payment could be made in the currency of the purchasing country. Whether these aircraft ever saw service was another question. Sometimes changed political relationships with the Soviet Union caused the supply of spare parts to stop, and the MiGs would sit on the ground indefinitely. When the MiG-21 entered service in 1959, its direct Western contemporaries were the American Lockheed F-104 and the French Dassault Mirage. There's no doubt that the MiG was much more maneuverable than both of them. The MiG's long service life brought it into direct comparison with a new generation of lightweight single-engine fighters, the design of which it in some ways influenced. Among them were the American General Dynamics F-16 and the Northrop F-5. Operational cost relates directly to takeoff weight, and like the MiG-21, these new fighters were relatively inexpensive to run. Also, like the MiG-21, they were affordable by countries with small economies. Soviet Air Force philosophy required quantity over quality and sophistication. It dictated that fighter aircraft should be simple and capable of being produced in large numbers. It also required that aircraft should be as close to absolutely reliable as possible. Under the Soviet system, only the most elementary maintenance was carried out by the combat units themselves. Engines were used for relatively low numbers of hours, removed from the aircraft and taken away for complete overhaul. They were replaced by other engines fresh from the maintenance depot. This meant that engine durability or long life was not a crucial factor, and engine design did not need to be sophisticated. Although the MiG-21 was originally designed as a lightweight daylight fighter, the airframe was so successful that it was adapted for ground attack, tactical reconnaissance, all-weather interception, and close combat. Depending on the mission, it could carry a variety of weapon loads, even including 550 pounds of bombs. But the basic armament was cannon, and air-to-ground and air-to-air missiles. Most later generation MiG-21s could be fitted with two solid fuel rocket boosters to cut takeoff runs by half. Throughout the 1950s, the major Soviet air shows became a great tradition. They were usually held at Tushino Airport, and Western military analysts attempted to keep a close eye on them in the hope of getting information about new Soviet aircraft. They were also used as an opportunity to show new defense hardware to Soviet allies and traditional client countries. After 1961, the tradition was dropped. But in 1967, one major air show was held at Domodedovo, just outside Moscow, and MiG-21s, even an experimental short takeoff version, were well represented. The air show was a gold mine for Western observers because apart from the MiGs, a number of revolutionary new Soviet aircraft were glimpsed for the first time. But Domodedovo 1967 was to be the last of the great military air shows for many years. In the 1950s and 60s, the Soviet Air Force did not have a dedicated aerobatic team as an equivalent to Western groups like the American Thunderbirds. But the tradition of formation aerobatics was kept alive at the Kubinka Air Base, 40 miles west of Moscow. When the MiG-21 became available in the early 60s, its low-speed maneuverability and its straightforward flying characteristics made it an ideal team aerobatic aircraft. One of the formations developed to show off the MiG-21 was this shape, representing the delta planform of the MiG-21's wings. It was also exactly the shape of the Russian musical instrument, the balalaika. The MiG-21 was designed as a war machine to serve in the defense of the Soviet Union. But by far the major part of the MiG-21's combat hours have been flown by pilots of non-Soviet origin. For many years, this caused Western defense analysts a problem in assessing its real effectiveness as a fighter. It was difficult to know whether they were assessing the hardware or the performance of pilots who may or may not have been properly trained. Throughout the 60s and 70s, the MiG-21 was involved in combat. The Indo-Pakistan War of 1965, the Six-Day War between Arabs and Israel in 1967, and the Iran-Iraq War of 1980 all used MiG-21 aircraft supplied by the Soviet Union. But Soviet Air Force aircraft, flown by Soviet pilots and controlled by Soviet ground controllers, were never really tested in battle. In late 1962, the Cuban Missile Crisis erupted, threatening nuclear confrontation between the United States and the Soviet Union. Surveillance flights above Cuba took photos which revealed that the Soviet Union was building offensive missile and bomber bases in Cuba. The Soviet Union claimed that the bases were defensive, but U.S. President John Kennedy said the claim was false. He announced a naval and air blockade of Cuba to stop the shipment of more military equipment. Surveillance photos revealed medium-range ballistic missile bases and surface-to-air missile assembly depots. They also revealed the presence of Soviet fighter aircraft, including MiG-21s, and airstrips for their use. But Cuba was not to be the site of the first confrontation between these new Soviet fighters and American aircraft.
My fellow Americans, as President and Commander-in-Chief, it is my duty to the American people to report that renewed hostile actions against United States ships on the high seas in the Gulf of Tonkin have today required me to order the military forces of the United States to take action in reply.
As the Vietnam War escalated and American troops struggled to come to terms with a war fought in conditions unsuited to their equipment and training, the Soviet Union began to supply the North Vietnamese with MiG-21s. From 1965, they were transported through China, and when they arrived in Vietnam, Soviet military advisors were shocked to find that the latest electronic equipment had been stripped by the Chinese and replaced with their own domestic version. The MiG-21's major opponent in Vietnam was a giant of a fighter, the McDonnell Douglas F-4 Phantom. In North Vietnam, it was a David and Goliath struggle. The Phantom was an immensely successful aircraft. It was a two-seater, three times as heavy as the MiG-21. The MiG was more maneuverable, especially at low speeds, and more difficult to see in the sky because of its size. North Vietnamese pilots adopted ambush tactics, appearing suddenly and trying to force the Phantoms to drop their weapon loads. This North Vietnamese pilot says that in 6 months from April to October 1972, He shot down 6 American planes, including 4 Phantoms. He says that the MiG-21 was superior to the Phantom in several vital flight performance areas. There is a discrepancy between American and Soviet estimates of the combat results between MiG-21s and F-4 Phantoms in Vietnam. America claimed a 2-to-1 kill ratio Phantoms against MiGs. The Soviets claimed that the Americans were counting MiG-17s as well as MiG-21s. They said that if you isolate the Phantom's performance against the MiG-21 in the late 60s, the results were 2-to-1 in favor of the MiG. Whatever the result, U.S. authorities were disturbed by the success of the smaller and lighter Soviet aircraft. The U.S. Air Force held a lightweight fighter competition. The Northrop Company, whose lightweight F-5 had been a great export success as a fighter and fighter bomber, built one prototype, the F-17. The other competitor in the race was the General Dynamics Company. Their F-16 won the competition and became the first of a new generation of light and highly maneuverable American fighters. Traditionally, Soviet aircraft were supplied only to Soviet client countries. The MiG-21 was a breakthrough because it was bought by countries like Finland and India, traditional customers for Western aircraft. In fact, India went further. It negotiated a production license with the Soviets, and Hindustan Aerospace built about 350 MiG-21s over a period of 21 years. The last aircraft came off the production line in 1988. China received 50 aircraft from the Soviet Union just before a major disagreement erupted between Nikita Khrushchev and Mao Zedong in 1963. The Chinese copied every part of the MiG-21 and produced their own version. Eventually, the Chinese Air Force had almost 3,000. The MiG-21 was the smallest and most cost-effective of the world's original Mach 2 fighters. Its influence on fighter aircraft design will last well into the next century.